In a world ravaged by spiritual deception, where much of Christianity has led into grave doctrinal error, many churches and Christian bookstores are not safe places anymore. So what is a spiritual seeker to do? They are to test all things and hold fast what is good. My name is Chris Lawson, and this is Spiritual Research Network. Our goal is to proclaim the gospel, encourage biblical discernment, and expose dangerous mystical practices in the world and in the church. Join me now as we examine the issues of our day in the light of God's written word. Welcome to Spiritual Research Network Radio Podcast. My name is Chris Lawson, and I'm the founder and director of SRN. And the message you are about to listen to is from a radio interview that I did with Bill Feltner of Pilgrim Radio out of Carson City, Nevada. The interview was broadcast in various stations in Nevada, California, Wyoming, and also a radio station in Montana. The content of the interview basically covers Western culture embracing yoga. We also discussed what is yoga, the understanding, the meaning of the occult. What is the occult? What is Kundalini energy, the ultimate aim behind all yoga practice? We discussed the dangers of yoga from a psycho-spiritual and psychophysical emergencies, as well as symptoms of Kundalini awakening. We talked about Christian yoga in the context of Christians doing yoga in churches and the conflict between yoga, Christian yoga, and the gospel of Jesus Christ, the biblical gospel. It is my hope and prayer that as you listen to this, you'll be thoroughly warned about the dangers of yoga and also be able to share this with your friends or family or loved ones who are doing yoga that really have never taken a second look or even a first look at what could go wrong when they're yielding themselves to yoga practitioners, their gurus, the local gym teachers that are practicing and doing yoga. If you'd like more information, you're more than welcome to visit our website at www.spiritualresearchnetwork.com. And you can also purchase my booklet, Yoga and Christianity, Are They Compatible? Through Lighthouse Trails Publications. Their website is lighthousetrails.com. Thank you for listening, and I hope this is educational, informative, and also a warning that you will heed.
Today on Pilgrim Radio's His People, Chris Lawson with a warning about combining yoga and Christianity.
And again, it goes straight back to a philosophy, a worldview that is absolutely diametrically 100% opposed to Scripture, to Jesus Christ and what He stands for, to biblical Christianity, and to the cross of Christ and His resurrection. It is Antichrist through and through as a philosophy.
Chris Lawson, next. As you'll hear today's guest explain, the practice of yoga is very popular in the U.S., in the culture in general, but also in Christian circles. My guest is Chris Lawson, head of the Spiritual Research Network and author of the booklet, Yoga and Christianity, Are They Compatible? Chris, why did you want to write on this topic?
Well, the idea kind of came to my mind about 20 years ago, and I've been accumulating books and research for a long time. And it just kind of came to a head a couple years ago when I've seen so many Christians, you know, as we've been doing missionary work and pastoring and in the Christian context, seen so many, you know, sincere believers wanting to know the Lord, but then they're going off and doing yoga at the same time. And so I thought it'd be something pertinent to what's going on, especially with the rise of yoga, the Western world embracing New Age movement and yoga and all this stuff. It's a small booklet, but I would love to write an encyclopedia on the dangers of yoga if I had the time and resources to do so. But this encapsulates the basics of it, and my heart is to help people and to be gracious in doing so, but to provide the facts about it and give the firm foundation and reiteration of what the Christian gospel really is in light of the dangers of yoga.
Before we discuss what it is, how popular is yoga?
I'm going to throw out a few statistics here. In my booklet, I gave statistics about the Yoga in America study 2012, which was published by Yoga Journal. And Yoga Journal actually is a humongous publication, and there are numerous countries. But back in 2012, they did this study that 20.4 million Americans were practicing yoga, compared to 15.8 million the previous 4 years in 2008. Well, ironically, they just came out with another study in 2016, And I'm going to give you some of these statistics here because it's actually quite mind-boggling how much yoga is growing. So these statistics, again, these are from the 2016 Yoga in America study. In the USA today, there are approximately 36.7 million yoga practitioners. And again, that's a jump up from the 20.4 million in 2012. Practitioners nowadays spend $16 billion on classes, gear, and accessories. And most of that spending is on classes and instruction. Approximately 72% of people that are practicing yoga in the U.S. are women, and approximately 28% are men.
So it's really a strongly female form of exercise.
Yes, it is. Also, 34% of Americans, or approximately 80 million people say they are likely to try yoga over the next 12 months.
That's amazing.
That's mind-boggling.
Yeah.
80 million people. Now, again, this is a survey. It's a study. So, you know, the numbers can go up or down a bit, obviously. And this was kind of a shocker to me in this study. They say 75% of all Americans agree that, quote, yoga is good for you, end quote. And I read that. I think, well, you know, if you go to the subcontinent of India, you'll be utterly shocked by what you see yoga produces. It has produced an entire subcontinent culture that worships rats, snakes, monkeys, cows, reincarnation. You know, so there's an occult philosophy that goes with it. You know, these are just statistics, but in my booklet, I say Western culture has embraced yoga, and it has. It's a new age, panentheistic philosophy. And the thing is, most people that are getting involved with yoga, they've never even read a definition of what yoga is from the dictionary.
Well, let me, if I could ask you that, Chris, what is yoga? I mean, in terms of, at least at the beginning, I think most people view it as an exercise, perhaps a mind and body exercise, stretching and breathing and balance and all of that. And of course, you're, as a Christian and as one that's done research, you're bringing the spiritual aspect to it. What about that? The dictionary definition, just sort of foundationally, what is yoga?
Okay. Bill, I'm going to give you just real practical here. I'm going to quote from a few different resources.
Okay.
But before I do that, I want to preface this and say the goal of yoga is to train the body in order to train the mind in order to realize one's own divinity, oneness with the universe, Brahman, the divine consciousness, Hinduism.
And where do you get that definition?
I took that right out of a book called Yoga for Magic. According to Webster's New 20th Century Dictionary, yoga is, quote, a practice involving intense and complete concentration upon something, especially deity, in order to establish identity of consciousness with the object of concentration. It is a mystic and ascetic practice, usually involving the discipline of prescribed postures, controlled breathing, etc. Okay, and then here's the Merriam-Webster Online Dictionary, which also adds this piece of the definition. Quote, a Hindu theistic philosophy teaching the suspension of all activity of body, mind, and will in order that the self may realize its distinction from them and attain liberation, end quote.
These are just dictionaries.
And, years ago, I thought, what is yoga? Well, I looked up in the Webster's Dictionary. This is literally like 20 years ago. I was pastoring church here on the Central Coast of California. People in the congregation were starting to go to the gym to do yoga, Christian yoga.
Mm-hmm.
And I started talking to them. I'm like, wait a second, I'm just going to look this up and research it. And I was like, yoga is yoking. The word is a Sanskrit word, yuj, Y-U-J. And it means union, to be yoked with Brahman, the divine consciousness of Hinduism. And again, it goes straight back to a philosophy, a worldview that is absolutely diametrically 100% opposed to Scripture, to Jesus Christ and what he stands for, to biblical Christianity, and to the cross of Christ and his resurrection. It is anti-Christ through and through as a philosophy. That is where yoga comes from. It comes from India. And it actually predates Hinduism. So, Bill, I'm going to give you one more definition here, and I think this is really imperative because this comes right from Cindy Lee. She's an expert yogi and the writer for Yoga Journal.
Okay.
And she defines yoga this way. Quote, the word yoga from the Sanskrit word yuj means to yoke or bind and is often interpreted as, quote, union, end quote. And then she goes on to say, quote, the Indian sage Patanjali is believed to have collated the practice of yoga into the Yoga Sutra an estimated 2,000 years ago, end quote. And then she, you know, she goes on, and I mean, I've got volumes of literature that we've accumulated in the research library for Spiritual Research Network, you know, that gives all of these definitions, and they all basically coalesce into this one thing about training the body, train the mind to realize your oneness with the divinity, with Brahman, self-realization, the self-God. And unfortunately, a lot of this type of philosophy and these teachings are being percolated into the Christian church through what's known as contemplative prayer, contemplative centering prayer, Christian meditation. There's all different types of different Christian meditation now, this mystical and oriented process. And so, you know, the thing is, Bill, is when you actually look at the definition of how the yogis from India define Hinduism, yoga, the occult practices, the siddhis, the postures, the asanas, the poses, the pranayama, or the controlled breathing to try to control this breath, you know, and unlock these occult chakras, they call them, in the body, these energy centers. You read this and you go, I can't believe Christians are engaging in this, and they don't, many of them don't want to hear the facts about it. So, again, it goes back to my concern. I have a heart concern, not just from a you know, a general human walking the planet that's concerned about people getting involved with something dangerous, but from a Christian perspective, a pastoral perspective, a missionary perspective. One gentleman contacted me years ago when I was living in Scotland, and this was actually right about the time that Susan Bordenkircher came out with her book, Yoga for Christians. And this gentleman contacted me, and he said his life had literally been dismantled. He got involved with yoga, and then he started, you know, going after the yoga philosophy, and he just got sucked in deeper and deeper to the point where it literally almost destroyed his Christian faith. He had physical problems. He had mental problems that were caused because of yoga and the forces of darkness that came with the yoga practices. And I believe oftentimes, you know, if somebody is yielding themselves to a yoga teacher who's involved in, you know, any form of this New Age occult philosophy, they've been involved with New Age writers, authors, it can have a detrimental effect on people, and especially Christians, too. Bill, I did an audio, you know, it's an MP3 on my website, How to Destroy Your Christian Faith Through Yoga. And it's, I just basically go in, and there's actually five or six different audio messages I've done on this that very clearly delineate what can happen when a Christian engages in yoga practice and doesn't use discernment and find out where this comes from and what the teacher's bringing that they're yielding themselves to.
Several minutes ago, you mentioned that yoga, it's a belief system. It's part of Hinduism, as I recall you saying, and you're saying it's diametrically opposed to the Christian faith. Can you give a couple examples using scripture where it's opposed?
Well, yes. Well, I think, first off, I mean, Paul the Apostle said in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14, he said, be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Now, obviously, in the context there, he's talking about marriage. You know, a Christian shouldn't marry a non-Christian, and there's obviously an unequal yoking. But he goes on further, and he talks about, you know, what does light have in common with darkness? What does, you know, Christ have in common with Belial or Satan? Paul also says in Ephesians chapter 5, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. Okay, Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 21, you cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils or demons. You cannot be partakers of the Lord's table and of the table of demons. Okay, so there's obviously this idea of Christian, it's not just sanctification, we're set apart for the Lord, for his glory. We're setting our bodies apart for him. But we are to be separated from those who are practicing the occult works of darkness and divulging in evil practices and whatnot, to be separate as a Christian. So what I do is I go back and say, well, what is the actual teaching that people are teaching about yoga that brings forth then the actual practice or the implementation of that philosophy? Okay, so if I go back to the yoga worldview, which is what we would call the occult, or the hidden things, the psychic worldview, versus a biblical worldview, which you and I get from Scripture, reading it at face value, we see there's an absolute contradiction here. The occult psychic view teaches that everything is divine, and there's only one divine reality or spirit, and that's called pantheism, a pantheistic monism. All is one, all is God. The biblical worldview, the traditional theism, is that God is the creator, not part of the creation, and he's distinct from the creation, his creation. Okay, we see that in Genesis 1:1. So you've got two completely different worldviews. The pantheistic, monistic one versus the traditional Christian theistic view. Then the downflow of that is the occult psychic yoga worldview is that God is ultimately impersonal. God is a force. Man is inwardly divine and one essence with God. Evil is an illusion. You know, salvation comes through yogic practices, through self-realization, through awareness of personal divinity, the gaining of psychic practices and occult techniques, and a result of that is psychic powers. And we're talking about demonic possession, demonic influence, spiritistic powers, you know, and all sorts of stuff that go along with that. So then the end view of the psychic worldview, Bill, is eternal cyclical incarnation, or we would call it reincarnation. Now, contrasting that, the biblical worldview with traditional theism, God is loving, God is personal. We see that in John 3:16. Man is a creature. He's created in God's image, but he's not inwardly deity. Genesis 1:27.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Evil, in the biblical worldview, evil is a concrete fact which operates in opposition to God's nature. Why? Because God is holy. We see that in 1 Peter chapter 1, chapter 3. Hence, we come to the view of salvation. Biblical salvation is based on the atonement of Christ's vicarious suffering and death for sin, and salvation is received as a free gift by God's grace alone through faith alone in Jesus Christ alone. We see that in so many places in the New Testament. And again, that's contrary to the salvation of yoga and Hinduism, the occult worldview, which comes through these personal meditative yogic postures and practices and et cetera.
Well, let me ask you this, Chris. Obviously, you mentioned there have even been books written about Christians and yoga. I read an article not long ago at the ChristianityToday.com website, and the lady essentially said that she enjoys yoga. It's a stretching, breathing, relaxation technique. She doesn't notice anything religious going on whatsoever. Nothing religious is said. That would be the first question. What about people that are essentially don't see anything religious about it? It may have that Hindu background, but in terms of what's actually happening in the yoga class, and the second part of the question is, why not, if there's a problem, why not Christianize it? Start it with Christian prayer in Jesus' name. Do the postures while listening to Christian praise music.
I've been asked that question so many times, Bill, and I'll try to give you some answers here. When people throw that out at me, I say, you know what? Can you become a world-class Olympian athlete without doing yoga? Obviously, the answer is yes,
mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
It's a hypothetical question that I throw out there, but it's like, well, you know, how many thousands of Olympic athletes through the ages have gotten in perfect physical condition training in order to compete in the Olympic Games without doing yoga? Okay, so yoga is more so a cultural, popular, you know, trendy type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
The other one, too, is especially for Christians. Now, in my booklet on page 15, I listed a few of the names here of, quote, Christian yoga ministries. I could have listed about 100 more. So we've got Yahweh yoga, holy yoga, body prayer, Christ-centered yoga, New Day yoga, Trinity yoga, yoga devotion, grounded in yoga, be still yoga, atoning yoga, extending grace, and the list goes on and on. Well, again, I would just simply go back and say, look, what does Scripture teach? Because Scripture is the final arbiter of truth, right? When Paul the Apostle says that we are to separate from and not be unequally yoked with unbelievers, okay, yoga essentially is a practice and a discipline that comes from non-Christian yogic India.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so that's, you know, this yoga has come west. It's been coming west for the last 100 years or so. I mean, it was even back in the 1850s. I mean, I've got literature and I've done research on, I've got many different historical books on yoga that talk about yoga first coming to Britain and then coming to the U.S. The idea of postural yoga, the whole purpose of that is to train the mind, again, to train the mind to recognize one's divinity. And I tell Christians, I say, look, the postures of yoga are designed to open you up to these psychic occult forces, which are actually evil spirits. They masquerade as the chi, the force, kundalini, what's called prana or shakti, qigong, people that do qigong or qigong. It's this occult force these spirits masquerade and they bring about a change in people's consciousness. Literally, people that get involved with yoga in many different avenues, they become demonized.
But Chris, what if they're doing it from the perspective of a Christian and they're not having it anything to do with Hinduism? But it's, as I say, it started with Christian prayer. It's done with Christian music. It's done with scripture being spoken. And basically, the only thing that it has in common with Hinduism is maybe the stretching postures. But everything else about it is Christian.
Everything else about it is Christian, except the name itself, Christian yoga. Like, you go back, what is yoga? Yoga means yoking with Brahman, the divine consciousness of Hinduism. There's a yoking that occurs. You know, and God's very clear when he told the Israelites, numerous places in the Old Testament, do not become like the nations around you. Obviously, he's talking to the Jews at that point, not Christians in the New Testament.
Yeah.
Don't become like the surrounding nations. Don't worship the way they do. Don't give into the occult practices the way they do, because they will defile you. All right? And people think, well, I'm a Christian. I can do this. It's not going to defile me. Well, what happens if a Christian goes to the local gym and does hatha yoga? Because that's what most local gyms are putting forth, the hatha yoga postural asanas, the practices, the poses. Well, hatha yoga means sun, moon, yoga. And it's an occult practice all over India. So they're doing these practices that are worshipful postures to Hindu deities. And that's what a lot of people don't recognize is, If you do look at the literature that's written by the Hindu yogis, and there are absolute masses of material. I was on the Government of India website this last week, and I was digging through documents from various different famous yogis in India, and they're talking about, you know, these are worshipful postures to these Hindu deities. Does Yahweh, the God of all creation, does he want people who are to be separated unto God, to himself, does he want them doing worshipful postures to Hindu deities? Of course he doesn't.
So that's interesting, Chris. You're saying that the postures themselves, apart from anything spoken, have religious significance relating to Hinduism.
They do. They do. I'm going to give you examples real quick. Brooke Boone is very famous. She's started holy yoga. And she calls it the exercise for Christian body and soul.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, holy yoga is now a huge phenomenon. The back of the book is endorsed by Father Thomas Ryan, author of Yoga Prayer and Prayer of Heart and Body, Meditation and Yoga as Christian Spiritual Practice. And they're basically mixing Hindu meditation practices, contemplative-type centering prayer practices, with yoga, with Christian scriptures. So that's one example. Yoga for Christians, Susan Bordenkircher wrote the book, A Christ-Centered Approach to Physical and Spiritual Health. The back of that is endorsed by Max Lucado and Claire Cloninger. And then another example would be Laura Willis, who started the video series Praise Moves, a Christian alternative to yoga. And in there, I give her the benefit of the doubt, Laurette has very clearly refuted Hinduism in her booklet for the series Praise Moves. I'm sitting here looking at these books, holding these as I got them,
mm-hmm.
and this DVD series here, you know, she refutes Hinduism, and yet I went through this book, there's over 20 postures that come straight off the Yoga Journal website. So basically, it's the postures have been given a Christian title, and they're saying this is not Christian yoga even. It's praise moves, or, you know, it's holy yoga, or it's yoga for Christians. But again, when I go back, Bill, and I look at the images, when I look at the postures that are drawn out, that are in the occult Hindu literature, and the explanations are there, it's stated, it's fact, it's part of Hindu occult India. And they say, these are the postures to Hindu deities. This is what will open you up in order to be controlled by the spirits, to be taken over, and to engage in possession states. When I look at the history of yoga, a history of modern yoga, American Veda, Yoga Body, The Origins of Modern Stretch and Practice, and the list goes on and on. There are books written by the most radical occultists of the last, you know, two centuries. And then I say, well, and I try to warn Christians. A lot of people, they get upset with me. I'm like, look, I got 200 books in our library that deal with this. And most of this is not written by people in America. They're quoting the gurus from India. So I'm passionate about telling the truth about this because there are so many people that are being messed up by yoga and even the physical practices. Even GQ magazine is warned about the dangers of postural yoga messing people up physically.
Of course, it's not written from a Christian viewpoint.
No. And there's a lot of secular material that's not written from a Christian perspective that warns about the dangers of yoga. I mean, if I can just snap off real quick here, just a few of these books: The Hidden Dangers of Yoga and Meditation by Del Pay, The Serpent Power, The Secrets of Tantric and Shaktic Yoga by Sir John Woodruff, otherwise known as Arthur Avalon. There's another one written by a man who's not a Hindu or yogi, The Science of Yoga by William J. Broad, The Risks and the Rewards, Kundalini for the West, A Foundation for Character Building, Courage and Awareness. Christina and Stanislav Grof have written a book called The Stormy Search for Self, and they talk in there about the dangers of yoga. I mean, there are volumes and volumes and volumes. Psychological effects of yoga. The Kundalini Experience by Lee Sinella. He was one of the first people that had compiled the dangers of what's called the Kundalini Experience. Again, a lot of Christians don't know this. I think the bulk of Americans probably don't know this. Kundalini is the Shakti force or serpent power of Hinduism. And it's supposed to be a female deity that is a force that resides at the base of the spine. And when people do yogic postures, including Christians, it can, quote, arouse this Kundalini serpent power, which, again, is a spiritual force. It's not Christian by any means. It's not the Holy Spirit. This can then yield, people can yield themselves to this power. And this is the power that is the aim of all yoga postures, is to arouse the Kundalini serpent power. Yeah, it's dangerous. It can be very dangerous. So I tell Christians that, and, I just say, look, do the homework. It's out there. And, again, Bill, I just want to reiterate, too, the importance of looking at the facts is, and why I'm doing this is my heart is in this. I love the Lord. I love His Word. And I've seen so many people damaged in spiritually abusive practices that are mystical, that are, contemplative, the yoga, and we just want to get the word out and really try to help people.
You've been listening to His People on Pilgrim Radio. Many thanks to today's guest, Chris Lawson, head of the Spiritual Research Network and author of the booklet, Yoga and Christianity. Are they compatible?
For further information on this subject, remember that Spiritual Research Network offers a growing selection of books, articles, videos, and audio messages that will help equip you to effectively proclaim the gospel and encourage you to be biblically discerning in these last days. You can visit our website at spiritualresearchnetwork.com. My name is Chris Lawson, and I want to thank you for your interest in and support of our Spiritual Research Network ministry.